Hey, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Select Start. I'm your host, Brian, and joining me is my illustrious co-host, Chris.
Hey, thought you were going to say lovely.
My lovely co-host, Chris. And joining us this week, a very special guest for any fans or anybody who listened to the old CrystalCore podcast that I used to host. My co-host, Danny, is joining us this week.
Hey, everybody. Please know that Chris is lovely.
So we kind of teased this on a previous podcast. Danny and I've remained, you know, friends ever since the kind of the show kind of fell apart. And that, I mean, we're not going to get too much into the rise and fall of the CrystalCore podcast on this episode. Hopefully we can entice Danny to come back and do another show in the future to kind of really get that kind of history, the ups and downs. There's a lot of stuff going behind the scenes, and you know, we put together, I think, a pretty decent podcast. And I know a lot of people still to this day will reach out to me and ask, like, hey, how's Danny doing? And so I wanted to invite him on the podcast to, you know, basically kind of answer that question to everybody, as well as kind of, you know, obviously do our traditional segments of what we're playing. And then the big topic this week, the big main topic, is dealing with disappointment. How do we cope when a game lets us down? But that's a longer intro than we normally do. So let's go ahead and select start.
Talk about what we're playing and what we're looking forward to. I think we should probably start with Danny. So let us know what you're playing right now.
Nice. Always treating the guests well, right?
Absolutely.
That's our goal.
I appreciate it. So I can tell you right now, the thing that I play the most is Stellaris by Paradox Studios, Paradox Interactive. It's a 4X grand strategy space game in the vein of some of their other games like Victoria or Crusader Kings or Europa Universalis. But it's set in space, and that launched in May. And I've been averaging 10 to 15 hours a week in it, which is pretty good for a guy who's working, has a kid to take care of. Brian knows what I'm talking about. Wife is also working and in school. I'm trying to do grad school. That's the main thing. And I also am playing around a little bit with some other things in the genre, like Endless Space and Galactic Civilization 3, but it's mostly Stellaris.
So for somebody who's not interested is the right term, who's not informed or up to speed about that, what is that game? Like, how does it play? You said it's like a space strategy, and you named off a bunch of games that, like, I know I've got friends that some of them, like Crusader Kings, I've definitely heard about. So the strategy games that come to my mind would be Risk and Civilization and that series. Is it anything like that, or am I completely out of left field?
No, I mean, I think that's perfect. I think, you know, somewhere between the user friendliness of Civilization and the oh my God, how long is this game going to last of Risk, right? Like you start off by selecting a creature phenotype, everything from humanoids to fungus to birds to insects, and you assign an ethos. What do these creatures believe? What is most important to them? And this kind of takes place on a wheel where there are polar opposites. You can't be a militarist and a pacifist, for instance. And you can try. It's not going to work. No, the game won't let you. But you know, you start out with a single planet, a couple of fighter ships at the lowest level, and a science and a construction ship, and it's your job to figure out what to do in space, right? And that involves exploring, expanding your territory, exploiting the resources, and then sometimes, depending on how you're playing the game, exterminating everyone else in the galaxy.
Is it multiplayer, or is this like you're playing against like the computer, or both?
You know, it is multiplayer. It supports officially up to 32 players in the same game, which is
actually, that's what I needed. Actually, I was running short.
Yeah. So it's pretty impressive. I don't play the multiplayer because I would totally get killed, and it would be embarrassing for everyone involved, including the winner. But you know, one thing that really needs to be said about this game, kind of the nice twist, is that somewhere kind of mid-game, late mid-game, at that point where if you're playing Civilization V, you pretty much have an unstoppable tide sweeping over the map. You know you're going to win. In this game, there are things called crises, and I'm not going to describe them in case anyone decides to get it. I don't want to spoil anything, but you can be kind of moving along and everything looks like, well, I'm just clicking next turn, and kind of, there's not really a next turn, it's real time, but you can pause the game, you know, I'm just kind of clicking through things and trying to wait until the inevitable end, and then suddenly the entire galaxy changes kind of drastically, and it gives you a whole new reason to play toward the end game and can greatly change the dynamics.
Oh, interesting. Thank you. I guess my question would be for you, Danny. So it's been, you know, 3.5 years since we kind of wrapped up the Crystal Core podcast. Obviously, you know, like you know, and me and even Chris married, with the exception of Chris, you know, have a kid, and you're now like, either you just started grad school or you've been working towards that as well as a full-time job. You mind catching everybody up of what you've been up to as well these last 3 years?
Yeah. So big changes. I mean, when the entire time we were doing the Crystal Core podcast, I really was unhappy in my job. It was like physically and mentally dangerous for me. You know, it was an unhealthy work situation. Mm-hmm. And I hope that many listeners never go through that. But if you have, you know exactly what I'm talking about. And so I was getting to that point where I was like desperately looking, okay, I've got to get out of here. I've got to get out of here. And then a big change happened at work. And I got a chance to be the boss for a year, which always mm-hmm. makes people happy, right? And at the end of that year, I won Employee of the Year for some of the changes that I instituted in our department and some things that we did. This is at the University of West Georgia, mm-hmm. where I'm a professional staff member. And so at the end of that year, you know, well, before the end of that year, midway in that year, I knew, okay, I can be here. I can be successful here as I've been elsewhere in my career. And so I've been really into work. Once we got settled in with a new permanent leader, whom I like very much and I worked well with, I said, you know what, it's time to go back and get the terminal degree so I can be Dr. Danny. And so I started that in 2014. And about halfway through with that process now.
Yeah, if you're working on a PhD, absolutely halfway through. Yeah, that's awesome. That is fantastic. Have you kept up with, Final Fantasy at all? Or is it something where you just, you know, based off of, you know, obviously the disappointment launch of 1.0, that you just kind of said, oh, well, time to move on and obviously work on that PhD?
Well, you know, more than anything, it's just no time for MMOs right now. That's not the genre of game that you can play and do what I'm doing.
Right.
I think A Realm Reborn did plenty to bring me back to Final Fantasy. I mean, you know, there were things I definitely liked about 1.0, and we'll talk about disappointments later. Mm-hmm. There are plenty to talk about there, but I think Yoshi P and A Realm Reborn did enough that I think it's a really good game and one of the best MMOs out there right now. And so every time there's a major patch update, you know, I'll skim the article. I don't read for all the details. And I was really seriously tempted recently when a friend from the gaming industry, she's a published author, and so I'll plug her later, but she invited me to come and play with her. And that was really tempting. You're like, no, we're just about to start another term and I'm going to be in class. No, I can't do this for everyone's good.
Yeah, by the time you end up finishing that PhD, you know, it would be 4 or 5.0. So it'll be like just so much to do, see, and explore. And hopefully you'll get that time. Hey, Chris, so, you know, we're just catching up with Danny, but I want to ask kind of that question to you. So I know the answer because I watched the video. But why don't you update everybody on what you're playing?
I am playing Deus Ex, so keeping it within the Square Enix.
So they let you buy it finally without the ridiculousness.
I did. I had trouble buying it because my Xbox tends to recommend the most expensive version of everything and not let me know that there's a standard version available, no matter how I search for it. So it was like, yeah, you can definitely buy this. It's $90. So I don't think that's right. So I did eventually get the standard version there. I enjoyed the first, I'm probably 5 hours in. So please don't leave a spoiler in the comments. I'm very much enjoying it. And I'll be posting those videos slowly as I move along. it is a very Square Enix cinematic heavy game. So my only regret is that the seating in my house is either gaming seating or movie seating. And you really need both to enjoy Square Enix for everything you do. Because it's like, oh, I'm really rocking this game. It's like heavy, heavy combat. All right, settle in. You're going to have 35 minutes of video now. But I'm having a blast. It's well done for sure.
Sometimes it's nice when they do that to you, that they say, hey, by the way, this is going to be like a 3-hour cutscene. You might want to just like set the time aside and like go get the popcorn. Make, you know, in your case, because I've been to your house, as we always like to watch the progression in the video of how your room is coming, as your gaming room is coming along. But it's like, okay, get the couch, get the comfortness of it, and kind of go from there. Anything else? Because I saw your video. I thought you did a great job.
Use our Pizza Hut coupon code as included here. We can just go ahead and order this for you in anticipation of the next cutscene.
See, that'd be nice.
Yeah, that would be fantastic if they could know at what
that's
point.
So that
right when the cutscene pops up and tells me to pause, the doorbell rings.
Ding dong. Hey.
Pizza's here. Settle in.
30 minutes or less cutscene pizza.
When it shows up in games again, guys, remember that you heard it on Select Start. Right?
Yeah.
I mean, we haven't had the slash pizza since EverQuest 2.
Oh, heck yeah.
I did try to edit that video to kind of clip in and out, and I kept kind of the intro level as kind of a B-roll for the parts of the cinematic that were a little more, I guess, visually optional. Mm-hmm. Because there was definitely some filler imagery in there, but the voiceover was awesome, and it was great. It popped up right at the beginning of the game, and it says, if you've never played a Deus Ex game before, we'd be happy to catch you up. We warn you, this is going to take a while. Would you like to be caught up? And I was like, all right, yes I would. And it was very, very long, but very, very interesting.
It was good. It had me go, all right, I need to save up some, I need to make a little bit extra money this month, because I might have to pick up that game now, because I was like, the gameplay looks incredible, and the story, I was like, wow, like, that sounds amazing. And to Chris's point from last week's show, like, he called me the Square Enix guy, and it's like, that, you know, well, it's kind of true. I've just never played that series. Maybe I should, check that out. I guess as for me, what I'm playing, nothing's really changed. Destiny, I'm really looking forward to Rise of Iron. Played some Titanfall 2, the technical test, this weekend. They made, some updates. Really, actually, I was really excited by the changes that they made. It felt really better, really better. There's some bad grammar for you out there. But just all in all, like, pretty much in previous shows, come in with a whole new set of games that I'm playing. But with that, we're actually kind of at our halfway mark. And so we're going to take a quick pause. When we come back, we're going to be diving into our main topic, which is dealing with disappointment when games let you down. So stick around. We'll be right back.
Just like getting the Cracker Jack box with no prize in it, we're going to talk about what disappoints us now with gaming. And, I think we'll just kind of try to reverse it from the last segment. And Brian, why don't you start us off and talk about how do you deal with disappointment? Maybe can you give us an example?
Okay, well, I mean, so when I was thinking on this topic, I was thinking like, so, and obviously we was talking about bringing Danny on, I was thinking, okay, the failure of 1.0. But then I was thinking like, what more recently has happened? Because with Final Fantasy, it has such this, kind of this comeback from, the grave. It has this great story, that says like, here it was, we messed up, and then like we totally rebuilt it. And I can probably touch on a bit about kind of what it was like, obviously when the game launched and is a failure. But I was thinking, what has let me down, I guess, more recently. And the first thing that comes to mind would be, the Inafune game, Mighty Number 9. Now, Chris and I've talked kind of like Kickstarter can be like this crapshoot, and you never know what you're going to get. But I'm a huge Mega Man fan, and I was really hoping that this would be that spiritual successor, much like anybody else. So the disappointment, you know, wasn't so shocking in this case as it was with 14, because I felt like I was legitimately surprised that they really didn't get it with 1.0. But with Mighty Number 9, I just felt just utterly sad for the developer and for fans who were expecting it. And in my case, since I, you know, kind of avoid Kickstarter, I kind of held off on that. So there wasn't a financial regret. There was just this, well, I guess I'm just going to wait till next time. And then I just avoid like all, you know, because the internet, especially with Twitter and with any like online forums, you can get into the cycle of negativity. And so I tried to, you know, in this case, I tried to specifically avoid that, because there really in this case, like, isn't any kind of major update that's going to come fix the game. With some games, like with Final Fantasy, even though it launched with such, you know, just, it was just like slow, there's all kinds of issues, you know, when thinking on an MMO, I was like, well, they're going to patch it. Obviously they're going to fix X, Y, and Z, because I have that expectation, but that you know, never really came to fruition. They ended up rebuilding the whole thing, which was great. But like, there isn't any kind of, you know, patch that they're going to put in for Mighty Number 9 that's going to like immediately make me want to go out and buy it. There isn't any kind of patch like that. Is there, to Chris or to Danny, like, so that's kind of like a game that's let me down. What about you guys? Like, is there anything that comes to mind, I guess, within the last couple of years that has like really had you excited and then just kind of punched you in the gut when you got your hands on it?
I don't think that any one game has utterly let me down. I think it's more, and maybe this is just me being old and cynical, I think it has a lot more to do with the other side of this argument, where it's the setting expectations. Because Mighty Number 9, as a perfect example, was done by TJ Inafune, who is the guy who drew Mega Man. That was who he was. He was the original illustrator. So the idea that a guy that can draw a cartoon character would therefore make a great game doesn't make any sense when you say it like that. But that is not how it was marketed.
I thought he took up a leadership role, though. Like,
he did. He was a producer for many of the later Mega Man games, from Mega Man 8 forward, to my understanding.
Okay.
But he also took a part in some things like Dead Rising, and there were some definite. His resume is very impressive, but in many ways, his resume shows him as being kind of, I guess, success adjacent. And not that he's not playing a part, but that there's always a great team there that he is a member of. So he's a, you know, even a quarterback has an amazing offensive line. He has to have this other half. And so to say that he is kind of this one man show, and that he was never an indie developer. He was never all in one package. So he has some interesting insight that he brings to the table, but you know, he's not your programmer. He's not your, all these other people that really caused the game to not feel like a Mega Man game. And, you know, I mean, look at No Man's Sky right now. No Man's Sky, that's the hot topic, is how it let everybody down. But if you look, it was a 10-man studio that said, we want to make a procedurally generated space walking simulator. And they did it.
Right.
And then we all said, but in my imagination, you were better than that, and therefore you're terrible people.
Well, I get that. Like, I think that's essentially like where, you know, so it, we are there, like, so like, who's to blame? And it's, I would say that there's a part of us that play a role in that. It's that if you think this game, you know, I guess for lack of a better expression in my mind, is the second coming of Christ, it, you know, only that would then suffice. And most likely, that's just not going to be the case. Danny, I want to throw to you. Like, so managing expectations, is it all in us, the gamer? What's let you down recently?
Well, wow, I don't know how I can follow Chris. I mean, that was really well said, Chris. I think that was some good analysis. I don't, why are we not charging for this podcast? The thing I came into the show, because we had a topic that we had not discussed at all, that's intentional. You want to come in and you want to kind of just get it out there and let it all be real. The thing I came into the show to talk about was No Man's Sky.
Oh, now, interesting.
Not from the same point that Chris is talking about. Like, I wasn't that uber fan who was following every developer tweet. I never read the blog on this game. Like, I watched a couple of IGN videos and said, okay, I see that's cool. The expectations that I set that aren't real, because I think Chris has got it right. Like, it's a space walking simulator survival genre game. And I knew I was getting a survival genre game. I really thought there would be a greater sense of exploration and discovery than what there was in the game. And so my daughter and I went in, halvesies on it, and purchased it for the PS4. I've probably played 4 or 5 hours. My daughter has played maybe an hour. And last night I asked her, I said, are you ever going to play this game again? And she said, yeah, definitely I will. So for $30, I think I'll probably be able to sit with it okay and just say, hey, that's I took a chance on something. Because even in the end, I would want to support that kind of thinking of, you know, let's do something really outside the norm. But I think there is less game to that game than what maybe should have been at release.
Okay.
And so how do you deal with that? So my therapist says that you can't use drinking. So I'm a gamer. I'm just going to find something else to play. That's what it, you know, so I'm fortunate enough in my life to have the disposable income. And my daughter even has disposable income, even though she's a minor, right? That we could both throw $30 each at this game. And if we don't play it so much, we'll be like, okay, I'll just get another game. I mean, in fact, that's what she did. I mean, she saved her money for a while and just purchased a Japanese rhythm game for like $100 or something like that. I had to get a Japanese PSN account and do the whole, like, she's reading it in Japanese because she's self-taught for reading Japanese. And I'm just like, what do I click now? She's like, click this button. So that's where she went. I've pre-ordered Civilization VI. You know, that's where we're at. But maybe we should talk about pre-orders, because I heard a really neat thing about pre-orders among the crew here.
So on that note, so we were talking about on the previous podcast, talking about game reviews. And so we had a comment on the video. So I am known as Big T. Love that name. tends to say, like, so his reaction to our video on game reviews is says, and so dealing with disappointment, he said Destiny flopping, which is funny because it's sold like 25 million copies and has made Activision just ridiculous amounts of money. They've got other games and other things in the pot, but since you see Destiny come out, like, their stock has just gone through the roof. And so the game, you know, I get where he's coming from saying the game kind of was a flop, but for him it is. Like, so he felt that it did not, that Destiny in this case did not meet his expectations. And so for him, he's kind of vowed never to pre-order a game again. And, you know, and we were talking about that on game review, you know, the pre-order industry, which is kind of weird. Because like, look, when there was a physical game that I would go to a store to buy, doing a pre-order made kind of sense. So it's like, I want to get this game. And you know what? If it's not good, before I go pick it up, I know I can cancel that, or I can roll that $5 into a new, into another game. But since having kind of with this generation gone like 100% digital, the pre-orders really don't make as much sense. So you see companies try to incentivize it with, if you download this now, there's, you know, this discount, or you get this additional pre-order bonus stuff, et cetera, you know, and it's somewhat probably even tied with the physical medium. But I'm still in that habit of pre-ordering. I like to say, I want to have this game. I want to, you know, I want to buy it. And I tend to do that still to this point, but it is still that risk that I'm currently willing to take. So the three games that I have currently on pre-order, and as it come October, I'll get the fourth one. I've got Forza, I've got Gears, and I've got Final Fantasy 15. And in October, when I've got a new allowance, I'll be pre-ordering Titanfall 2. And as long as those tend to be good, I'll continue to probably be somebody who pre-orders rather than waits for the review. But that's usually based off of, like, I know this series, or this, I have this set expectation there, and so that's managed. What about you guys? Like, what are your thoughts on from I Am Known as Big T? I just love saying that.
No, I think Big T, that's the name. Big T. Really sticks here. So I think Big T and your statement are exactly opposite. You literally just said they sold 25 million copies. So you said it flopped, but he's now saying he won't buy here again. Mm-hmm. So No Man's Sky pre-sold like 200,000 copies over like Steam here in the US or some just ridiculous number for an indie studio. Mm-hmm. So the sales numbers say, line up and do it again. Who cares if they're mad? We are making money. Mm-hmm. You know, I wait around the line. I wait around in line and around the block to get a burger. And so they make a ton of money off of me. But that burger is so terrible, I never eat there again. Well, from a business standpoint, they save so much money because they only had to make a terrible burger instead of a good one. They made a ton of money. I don't understand the problem. I think that's the problem is the industry just looks so short-sighted right now. You just see mm-hmm. so many, there's very few companies out there that are saying, we're going to stick by our guns and we're going to do what we feel is right. And we're going to stand behind it. It's always, oh, WoW is too easy now because they bowed down to the players. Or it's always, you know, Nintendo is bashing YouTubers. And it's all these criticisms about these companies that do or don't respond. And that's really it on the head. I'm never pre-ordering again because of one game. Just like that. I'll never pre-order again, no matter the title. Screw it. I'm done with this. I think that's just an honest statement. I just think that's interesting. I guess I don't have anything to add. I just think that kind of is a statement of where we're at as gamers.
Danny, you got anything to add to that?
It definitely consumers have to make that choice, right? And mm-hmm. so a few years ago, the pre-order game was all about early access. And now early access is sold on Steam, right? So you buy a game that is already, it will tell you right there, like, this game's going to crash on you. The graphics are placeholders. Some of the text isn't written yet.
Yeah.
Would you please buy it for $29.99 and help us with development? So we're in a new stage of gaming pre-orders, like you said, Brian, with, you know, the physical copies aren't there. Even collector's editions now, you know, the Civ 6 that I pre-ordered is the digital deluxe edition. It's mm-hmm. not quite the 25th anniversary collector's edition. The reason why I went for that is for like $20 more, I'm getting the first whatever 3-4 whatever they promise. Don't take my word to read the content, but the first whatever number of DLC that you would normally have to pay for. So that's the new lure, right? Like, it used to be you could play the game before everyone else, get a head start, save your progress. And now it's more of like, you know, those season passes that came along for a while and were controversial, right? But they're still around because they were successful, mm-hmm. just like Chris said. So now it's we're bundling the game with a season pass. And for Civ 6, I know I'm going to get the game anyway. I had the $80. I pulled the trigger.
Okay, so with that logic, do you pull the trigger on Kickstarters?
I have only backed one Kickstarter so far.
What's the backing on Kickstarter? Because I've only done one as well.
I can't even tell you the name of it now because it's not out yet, right? Like,
I've summed up all Kickstarter campaigns.
The game I've backed,
done, but it's not out.
One game that I've backed is Bloodstained Symphony of the Night, which is the Castlevania, you know, I guess spiritual successor. So hopefully, you know, I was like, well, you know, oh, I don't know if I should do this, but I went ahead and pulled the trigger. So, you know, I should hopefully be mildly, you know, I'm setting my expectations to be like, if I get a game, then awesome. I always try to set my expectations low, and maybe it's some bit of a pessimist under the optimist in me, but same thing with walking into movies or anything. It's like, I try to keep my expectations in check. That were it should only be positive. If I go into thinking, you know, Suicide Squad, it's like, I expect it to be a crap movie. And then it's like, no matter what, I'm going to be entertained. And then I feel like I've got, you know, my money's worth, as opposed to thinking like, oh, this is going to fix the DC, you know, universe in movies. You know, a lot of people set that expectation and you see it time again. And then it's like, oh, there's this like fan anger. So like I bring up movies, and I know we're coming up to the kind of the end of our show, and I want to kind of bring up one last point, and it's kind of ties to what Chris brought up just a little bit ago. He said that we're making money, and it's like they did a study on movie sequels. So like you take Grown Ups, and then they had Grown Ups 2. People just panned Grown Ups 2 more so than the first one, but they said that Grown Ups 1 made like $39 million, and Grown Ups 2 made $140 million. And it's whether it's an informed group of consumers, most likely, and this is probably I would venture to be, I would love to see a study on this for gaming, but most likely it's that 2 next to the name, that whatever, instills some grander level of confidence that goes, oh, well, you know, I saw the first one, and maybe they rented the first one or something like that. Oh, let me go ahead and make that risk here. And that's the risk that I take when pre-ordering, because I look at, oh, I like this series, I'm going to go ahead and invest in this series. There's other sides of it that I do. Like if I pre-ordered the Mordor game that came out and absolutely loved it. But I was following the developer. I was reading up who's working on it, what their plans were. And so it was Shadows of Mordor. It's a great game. But that was like that rare exception that I take on a property that I'm not normally used to.
Why do we do this? Why do we do this? Because so I just Googled it because you just brought this up. Grown-ups. Yeah. Scored 62% with the audience on Rotten Tomatoes and a 10% on the tomato meter, which the tomato meter, literally anything above a 90 or below a 15 is worth watching for opposite mm-hmm. reasons. It's the middle ground where you're risking something. Yeah. Grown Ups 2 scored 54 with the audience and 7 on the tomato meter. So that is right in line with what we all expect about a sequel. Mm-hmm. Sequels are always worse. As the rule, and the exception is this just delight and surprise. Mm-hmm. So we'll all order pre-orders, you know, the Civ 6, things like that, where we know Civ 6, it says 6, they've done this before. I know what I'm getting. Kickstarters, they're usually a small enough buy-in. I'll risk $5. I waste $5 on much dumber things on a daily basis. I guess my question to kind of lead out, unless you guys have an immediate response, is why do we do this? Like, this whole conversation just brings up, it's actually a miscommunication. They're doing their job. They're producing a game and they're selling the best parts of it to us. And they're staying in business to continue to produce content for us. Mm-hmm. And then we're somehow disappointed. And we turn around and we say, I'd like to buy in for more money if you could promise it won't get better. Why do we respond in this way and then be upset? Why don't we just take it for what it is?
And that Danny, sounds like a great place for the listeners to chime in and give some feedback. Why do you guys do it? Why are you taking the same risks that we just talked about? Or why are you like Chris saying, this is it, I'm not pre-ordering again, I have been burned one time too many?
So Danny's a real professional there, just opening it up exactly because I was like, Danny, why don't you you can tell that he's podcasted before. So we're going to go ahead and wrap up the show right now. I want to throw it over to Danny if he wants to kind of plug or say any kind of final words. And obviously, yes, call out to the community, guys. If you guys have any kind of thoughts on kind of the big topic or even on what we're playing, please leave us a comment below. We're on YouTube, SoundCloud, and iTunes, blah, 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 blah. But anyway, so Danny, why don't you, any final thoughts or any kind of plugs that you'd like to make before we adjourn?
Sure. Quick fire in order. I want to say that I'm really looking forward to the remake of Dragon Quest VII on the 3DS. That'll be something I try to pick up in September, October, whenever it comes out. Mm-hmm. I do not think the podcast should charge money, not because of lack of quality, because I think stuff should be free for gamers whenever possible, and stimulating conversation like this is good for the whole community. I mentioned a novelist. Her name is Nicole Hamlet. She writes a series of novels about a heroine named Grace Murphy. The first one is Huntress. Very first few pages, you'll get a battle with a manticore, gets the action going right ahead. I think she just got the fifth novel out. Very nice lady, has been in the video games industry for a while. I say you know, if you want to focus on something positive, is we have so many games to choose from in an era. You know, I grew up where it might be months before you could get another game in your favorite genre. We all remember those like Super Nintendo, Sega Genesis games where like you found this RPG and it changed your life and the way you play games forever. And now you got to wait 8 months before you get another one. I buy a game per month easily. And that's an exciting thing for us.
Chris, oh, and Danny, if you can send me the link to like any information on that author, I would love to, you know, put a link in the show notes. But Chris, any final thoughts?
No, I just want to say hit that subscribe button. Definitely give us feedback. So thank you, Danny, for coming. We appreciate you visiting, and we'd love to have you on again on sometime, however that sentence phrases, and whatever word you want to hear those words. But had a blast today. I think these topics are bigger than we make them, so we'd love some feedback.
Absolutely. And guys, again, thanks so much. Thanks to Danny, our guest, for coming on the show. Thanks for Chris for obviously helping me out with the podcast. Like, favorite, subscribe. Most of all, and the most important thing, leave us a comment. Let us know what you think. So, guys, until next time, take care.
Listeners, that you're the stud exposed in the video. Hey, ladies, or gentlemen, if that's what you like, you should see Chris right now.
That's definitely getting into the.
Like, what the hell is going on?
She's like, every time you podcast with Brian, you always hear the weirdest crap.